evening, everyone. My name is Jacqueline Davis, and I have the pleasure of serving as the Barbara G. and Lawrence A. Fleischman Executive Director of the Performing Arts Library. And it's really wonderful to see you all here. This is such a special week, having the Royal Ballet here with us on campus. And I just wanted to say hello. And if you haven't been here before, there are collections of music, dance, theater, recorded sound, as well as film. We also have three exhibition spaces, one just across the hall, and Frank Sinatra on the first floor. And we do these public programs, over 200 a year, so you should come back and you should be a part of us because we do a lot and it's free. Now, the most special part about this afternoon for me is that Linda Shelton, the executive director of the Joyce Theater, has been one of my very best friends for something like, maybe 25 years. And so it was just great that we decided to collaborate on this evening so that you and we could be here for this special time and that I could say, one of my best friends is getting up to the microphone right now and I just love her. So thank you very much.
So much, Jackie. It's true. We've been friends for a very, very long time. And I wanted to thank all of her staff here at the Library for the Performing Arts for hosting this event, which is done in conjunction with the Joyce Theater's presentation of the Royal Ballet right across the plaza. There are tickets left. If you haven't purchased them yet, I hope you will go across the plaza and buy some tickets. So we're very pleased today to have Dame Monica Mason with us as our guest and David Pickering, who is a former soloist with the Royal Ballet, and he now serves as their education administrator and teacher, and he will lead our discussion. So please join me in welcoming David Pickering.
Yes, my name's David Pickering. I'm a former soloist dancer with the Royal Ballet Company, and I now work with learning and participation. So I'm outreaching to a new audiences of the future. It's really great to be here at the Lincoln Center. We've got a very, very exciting dance dialogue event for you. Can I just start with a sort of tedious housekeeping? I don't think it's been done already, has it? If you have a mobile phone, perhaps you might consider turning it to silent, or better still, great. And also, if I can ask that photography and videoing or filming is not permitted during this evening's insight. Thank you. So, let's get going. Song of the Earth. Today we're going to offer a very, very special insight into Kenneth Macmillan's Song of the Earth. It was choreographed in 1965, originally for Stuttgart Ballet. Kenneth Macmillan described the work simply as a man and a woman. Death takes the man. They both return to her, and at the end of the ballet, we find that in death, there is the promise of renewal. Using Gustav Mahler's Das Lied von der Erde, with old Chinese texts sung in German, the result is a powerful, modernistic masterpiece. And I'm very excited that we have somebody to talk about Song of the Earth, somebody who knows, I'm confident in saying, probably more than anyone, has more experience with this ballet than any other living person. Former principal ballerina of the Royal Ballet, former artistic director of the Royal Ballet, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dame Monica Mason. It was rejected by the board of the Royal Opera House. Why is that?
I think that perhaps they thought that Kenneth was still young and a little unproven and also that clearly this particular score was greatly revered. And I think that there were several members of the board who were very much opera people rather than ballet people, and therefore perhaps failed to have the kind of insight into where ballet was going, understanding Kenneth's vision, and not able to imagine that a dance work wouldn't trivialize the music in some way. That was the reason they gave Kenneth. They felt that the score was so glorious and that the dance might match it. And of course, I think it depends on the period of time you're in, and at that time the board was perhaps had some very powerful personalities on it. And as I say, Kenneth was still a relatively young man. I mean, he had only really started to choreograph for Covent Garden, for the main stage of the Opera House, in the 50s, middle 50s. And at that time had only made one act ballets. And so to be imagining that he could service this great 1 hour long score was perhaps, they were doubtful and nervous.
But this didn't stop Kenneth Whitman, did it?
I don't think anything ever stopped Kenneth. I think that, he perhaps saw it as a rather, it's never nice, is it, to feel that somebody doesn't have confidence in you. And I think that that's how he read it. And so he was slightly angry and felt that he would wait his moment. And of course, he must have gone on listening to the music and reading the poems again and again and again and again. So when the opportunity came in 65, having made Romeo and Juliet, let's remember, I mean, he created his first full-length ballet in 1965, and the idea that he went on in the same year then to make a masterpiece is quite extraordinary. And I think it was because John Cranko and Stuttgart would have welcomed Kenneth at any time. And the fact that here were these poems that were translated into German, it seemed like the perfect opportunity for Stuttgart to do this piece. And Kenneth had always enjoyed Stuttgart. He was a great friend of Cranko's. They worked together in the Sallisville Theatre Ballet in the very early 50s. And so here was an old friend saying, if they don't want you, we do. So he was off there instantly.
So not very long after the premiere in Stuttgart, the Royal Opera House gave its premiere in 1966. Of Song of the Earth by Kenneth Macmillan. Do you remember that night?
I do remember the night, and I also remember that there were quite a lot of people, members of staff, ballet staff, and also some of the dancers, went to Stuttgart to see it and came back sort of in awe of what they'd seen and said, this is, it's tragic that we weren't able to create it. I've always taken the line really that things happen how they happen, and maybe the piece that Kenneth might have made for the Royal Ballet might have been very different. It mightn't have had the kind of deep feeling that he was able to pour into it, because he was with people he greatly admired. Marcia Haiti, of course, one of the leading dancers in the world for many, many, many years, and a great ballerina, but a great artist, a great human being, and still alive and still really working so hard in South America and backwards and forwards to Europe, and she sits on panels and judges competitions and she coaches people, and she's never changed. I always adored her and admired her, and I think that she was perhaps the right person in the right place at the right moment to create such a great work.
And how was the performance perceived? How was it received, in fact, by the audience? Do you remember?
In London.
In London.
Oh yeah, it was went down the ball. Yes, it was. It was fantastic. I mean, everybody just recognised that this was a great work of art, and of course Marcia danced the opening night with Donald McCleary and Anthony Dowell, and I think also what was very special was that she had danced the role in Stuttgart with her partner was Ray Barra, who was again another amazing artist and somebody that Kenneth adored working with, and they came to teach us. And there is something absolutely wonderful about being taught when the people who are teaching you are young enough to get up and really do it. And Marcia was, of course, at full strength. Her powers were just enormous. And of course, then she danced the first night. So what is burnt into my memory is how she looked. And of course, she had this wonderful, intense face. I don't know how many of you remember, I'm sure lots of you remember her appearing with Stuttgart Ballet here in the 60s and 70s. And those sort of, she had pools for eyes, those dark pools. And that sort of, quite tragic she could be. But so sincere and so from her heart. And I think that was what Kenneth took, because she was such an extraordinary human being. And she was such a tower of strength to John Cranko. And I think the same to Kenneth. I think that she was able to reassure choreographers in the midst of the creative process and make them see that what she was doing was exactly right. And if they dried up at any point, she'd have ideas for them or suggestions, but incredibly sensitively, so that she knew exactly how to be a muse and how to devote herself to the person who was creating the work.
Can we talk a little bit about the ballet itself now? How would you describe it? Is it a narrative piece? Are there characters in it? Is it abstract?
It's really a human journey, I would describe it as, really. And I think because for Mahler, it was a score that he wrote at the start of the 20th century. He was grieving for the loss of his daughter, who had died very suddenly. He was an absolute workaholic and, of course, was busy conducting operas and his own music. And then he started to write song, and I think I'm correct in saying he started to write, first of all, the second song, The Loneliness, the autumn one, and then went on to write five and six, and then back to three and four, and finally number one. So he dotted about somewhat. But I think he was inspired by the poems, and he had also had the opportunity to hear a recording of some Chinese music, and that sort of that came in, filtered into him, and he used that. And I think that Kenneth, who had experienced the tragedy of his own father being gassed in the First World War, and Kenneth always said that when his father returned from the war, first of all, he never spoke about his experiences, but he also never really was the same person as he had been before 1914. And I think Kenneth had as great artists do, very often have a sense of their own mortality and a sense of what life is about. And this music just touched something in Kenneth. And so it's really a ballet about the human condition, about human beings, about men and women. Kenneth was always fascinated about what happened when you put a man and a woman together on stage. he used to say there's no such thing as an abstract ballet, because once you put a man and a woman together, there's an electricity, something happens. And of course there is, because otherwise they're not performing. And I think that the messenger is his feeling about how death is ever present in our lives. We don't want to think about it. We don't want to acknowledge it. But, you know, the Grim Reaper is lurking. And I think that that's what Kenneth did with the messenger. He doesn't make him menacing. He just makes him present. And at any moment, he stands close by the people. Sometimes he dances with them. Sometimes the choreography that was devised for him takes him in a different direction from everybody else. And then he returns again and dances with the group. And the woman also dances sometimes with the messenger. It's interesting because she doesn't really connect with him. He's masked, so in a way you can't quite see his face, but she's very aware of who he is and where he is. And so I think that what is curious is that there are parts of the music and parts of the ballet, therefore, that are very profound, and other parts that are really quite frivolous. The third song, the poetry talks about the ladies in their elegant silk gowns and sipping tea, and talks about beautiful porcelain pavilions. And there's this, and they're chattering, talking and chattering together. Well, of course, you don't actually do that in the ballet, but you can see where Kenneth was coming from, and when you read the poems. And then equally the same for the fourth song, which is about young girls, beautiful young women, picking flowers. You know, nothing very serious, nothing very deep. Natural occurrences in our lives, really. And then, of course, there's quite a lot of drunkenness in it. The men, of course, especially, not the girls. And again, the messenger he joins in the drunkenness. And then the sixth song, of course, is the Abschied, the farewell. And there's a sense there. I mean, even when I'm rehearsing the ballet, and I remember with Marcia when she first taught it, she never really told us anything. She allowed us to respond to the music. And that's really what you're doing. You know, Kenneth was never somebody who went into great long explanations about what his work was about. You could never dig anything out of him. And he used to say, if I don't like what you're doing, I'll tell you. And that was about as far as it went. And so you just got on with it. And it left you feeling a little uncertain, and you were always wondering what he was thinking. But of course, you totally trusted him, so you just went on and got on with it. And I think that's the same with every cast, that I try to say to them, you know, I'm not going to tell you too much. I want you to respond to the music. But at the same time, of course, what I've never lost is that vision of Marcia, her face, her fingers, her hands, how she used her arms, the power and strength. She had immense strength in her arms and in her upper body. And Kenneth used that to great effect. And in the pas de deux, the girls really have to use a lot of strength in their arms. And these days, of course, you know, I always say to them, get into the gym more. Lift some weights. Because you really have to push against the man, and he's pushing against you. So I think, you know, the choreography and the style of the choreography was absolutely groundbreaking. I mean, it was utterly unlike anything we'd ever seen before. And even today, I think, because it's so familiar to me, but I can still look at it and think, that's astonishing. I mean, first of all, it's unlike any of his other ballets. You don't see those steps in other ballets. And so you're constantly aware of its uniqueness. Laura Moreira as the woman, Nemaya Kish as the man, Jackson as the messenger, and working very much alongside me was Grant Coyle, who is the notator. He was at one time resident principal notator. He's now freelance, so he goes all over the world. And he is the keeper of a huge, an absolute encyclopedic memory for masses and masses of works. But of course, the Royal Ballet has always, in the last 50, 60 years, worked from Benish notation. I know Laba notation is well known. And of course, extraordinarily, New York City Ballet have always just relied on people and not notating anything. But Kenneth Macmillan was one of the first choreographers to really insist that as many of his ballets as possible should be notated. And thank goodness for it, because he made many works, same as Frederick Ashton. Most of his works from the mid-50s on were notated. And it's an essential part of remounting a ballet. Because if you, and this is not a criticism of people who do it differently, but if you are only relying on human memory, of course the memory plays immense tricks. You think you remember it was on the left foot, and it was probably not on the left foot. And once you know, and it's a much speedier way of digging some of these treasures out and putting them on stage. And so that little clip we saw there was a presentation for an invited audience at the Royal Opera House. And in fact, what we often do is we teach things from scratch. And the dancers are quite used to learning a section of a ballet with an audience. And they've got so used to doing it. And in the beginning, of course, people felt very vulnerable and said, oh, I don't want to be exposed to that. And people see me stumbling about and not knowing what I'm doing. But actually, it's really fascinating for an audience. And especially when you use that little section and you repeat it and repeat it and repeat it. And then, of course, when the audience comes to the performance, they really recognize that section. And it means something to them. And I think that if a ballet is new to you and a ballet is an hour long, it's a huge amount of information to try and absorb. And if there are little clues like that along the way, I think it can be very helpful and informative.
So what is the sort of parameter of your role when you're staging Song of the Earth? Where does it start? Where does it stop?
Well, in fact, with Song, I was in the studio with Grant only really for, particularly for the second song, where the woman is in the second song, and the sixth song. I attended the rehearsals for the other four songs, but because I didn't dance them, I don't have a personal experience. So then I'm dependent on some of the men in the company who've danced in the ballet before. The ballet master on this production was Gary Avis, who danced the man. And he actually danced the man at Darcy Bustle's farewell performance. So he knows the ballet really well, and he learnt it from Donald McCleary. So that's really, you know, almost from the original. And because if you've done the work a lot, and if you love something, you don't forget it. And I think that this ballet, for people who do remember well, it really just goes in. So then I would be in the rehearsal. Grant actually would place everybody in the studio. He'd introduce them to the opening bars of the music. He would count the score for them, and he would show them the steps. And so he actually teaches the ballet. And then I have my little say, Grant, can I just say something? And he said, of course. So then I had put in my, as we say in England, my pennyworth. And that's how we go along, really. So it's very much a collaborative thing. It's him teaching and me passing on. And eventually, I say more than he does. And then once the ballet is taught, he perhaps will be available for some of the stage rehearsals. Sometimes the notator can be there right up to the opening performance. And then they go away to another country, another company, to teach something completely different, and then the ballet staff take over.
And how about the casting? Do you have any say or any input into the casting?
Well, when I was the director, of course, I did have a say. lots of say. I think that was one of the most delicious things. But of course, it also meant that every now and again, you could admit to yourself that you'd made a boo-boo. You know, oh dear, I thought that person would be wonderful in this role, and actually they're struggling with it. You know, sometimes you take a risk and it really works, and other times you take one and it doesn't quite come off. In this instance, this time round, of course, Kevin O'Hare is now the director of the Royal Ballet, and one of the things I've tried especially to do is not to be a nuisance and not to get in his hair and not to irritate him in any way at all. So I said to him, are you going to want to cast Song of the Earth? Do you want some help? Do you want anything? And he said, may I do it and then show it to you? And I said, yes, that sounds lovely. So he did. And I agreed with all his casting, and he had seen, because he's been around and he's been working with the Royal Ballet for a long while now, he was company manager and then he was administrative director before he became the director. And so his experience with a lot of the repertoire has been terrific over the years. He's seen a lot of performances. He's made up his mind about which dancers he really likes and the roles that he would choose for them. And I think probably when he saw some of my choices over the years, he didn't necessarily agree, which is absolutely right. I mean, we all think differently. So this casting is Kevin's casting.
So Monica, in 1980, casting your memory back, you were appointed repetiteur to Kenneth MacMillan. So you were still dancing at that point. You were still very much a very active performing dancer. How did that sit? And also, did you notice that there was any room for interpretation? Were there any changes that Kenneth made while you were still there as an active dancer?
I found it very difficult, actually, David, in the beginning, because I was taking rehearsals and criticising my peers. You know, somebody I'd performed with last night, I was now in a rehearsal for a different ballet and saying to this person, yes, there are a couple of things that just need looking at. And I sense a little eyebrow going up, a little something. And which is natural, really, because they weren't used to my being at the front of the studio and watching them and commenting. It took quite a little while, and I have to say I found it uncomfortable. I tried to be very sensitive, but at the same time, I'd been instructed by Kenneth to get on with it and do a job. And so I was very nervous of it. It was hard. It took quite a while, and I found that in time, I really relished the fact that I would be taking a rehearsal and teaching someone a role who was much younger than me. And that way I could really start fresh with them. And I liked it. I always tell the story of how Kenneth MacMillan wanted to test me. And he said to me, this was when he became artistic associate of American Ballet Theatre. So he was flying backwards and forwards from London to New York a lot. And he said to me, I'm going to be away a lot, which is why I want you to be my assistant. And I want to know what sort of cast list you'll make when I'm not here. And he said, for instance, could you prepare a cast sheet for Romeo and Juliet for me? He said, just imagine you were the director and you were going to cast who you want in every role in Romeo and Juliet. And he said, I'd like you to try and do it in the next 3 or 4 days and we'll meet in my kitchen and we'll have a cup of tea and I'll have a look at it. So I worked like mad on my casting for Romeo and Juliet, and I went round to his house and we sat in his kitchen and had a cup of tea, and rather nervously I handed him my cast sheet for Romeo and Juliet, and very carefully he looked right the way down it. And he said, well, I can see you've done done it all, yes, and thank you for doing the exercise. And my comment is, how extremely boring. I took a deep breath and I said, oh, really? I wasn't expecting that. And he said, no, I thought you weren't. But he said, it is. He said, and it's boring because you've copied my casting. And he said, I don't want you to copy my casting. I want to know how you see this ballet. So he said, take it away, do it again, and really think out of the box. So I thought, oh, wow, this is great. He said, you know, just because you're seeing Mercutio as originally danced by David Blair, you're not forever going to look for a lookalike David Blair. You know, think really wide. And if the role sometimes was cast on quite a small person, and you think a tall person could do it, have a go. So I took the casts away, I made a much bolder attempt, and he was completely happy and said, now you understand what I'm talking about. Don't ever play safe. Go for it. So it was the most wonderful instruction, really. And that was Kenneth all the way through. That's how I knew Kenneth. He never wanted anybody, a dancer, young choreographers, musicians, designers, anybody to play safe. He hated careful. He hated tiptoeing into things. He liked you to, you know, sort of, even if you crashed into something and it was a disaster, at least you'd really gone for it. But he couldn't bear, as we say, pussyfooting around.
So going back to the question, the original question I asked about personal interpretation when you're staging Song of the Earth, do you think, what would Kenneth be thinking now? Is there any room for crashing in there or slightly doing it in a different way?
I think the main thing, I mean, Kenneth is always right in the front of my mind, of course, but, you know, it's many years now since he died, and there's no way of knowing what he would have said. What I know is that when I teach it, I try always not to make somebody try to do it like I did it. And I think that's true of most people who mount things and teach ballets, that you want to teach them to understand the essence of something, where the heart of the work is. You know, and things have a kind of perfume. You know, in Song of the Earth, the poems have a kind of perfume. And that's what you try to convey, really. And then, because every dancer wants to feel that their imagination counts for something, so that they're not just doing as instructed. In fact, one of the dancers today, I said to him, as it turned out, it was a him, and I said, you know, that particular section, you're still obedient. You're obedient to the step, to the position, and you're not allowing yourself to feel it, to make it your own. You're not wearing it, not living it. And I think, particularly with something like Song of the Earth, you know, people have got to really inhabit it, so that you bring your life and your breath to it.
And I think we're going to see a second excerpt here. This is a short clip, a live performance of Song of the Earth. We have the second clip. So, Molly, what's happening there?
That was the third song, a section of the third song, and I think you can even hear the sort of perhaps the influence that Mahler felt from Chinese music, and of course these movements, like as I see those lovely silk sleeves and the hands coming out of their silken garments, and of course the four couples sitting, supposedly drinking tea and chattering. I mean, we don't have dainty teacups, but I mean, it's the feeling, you know, it's fascinating how choreographers take an idea and turn it into dance. Endlessly fascinating. I think how fortunate we are as dancers to have experienced great creativity. the most amazing experience to dance this work. I think one of the most amazing and unusual aspects of the Song of the Earth is that the singers are on the stage. And there is a connection that you feel as the singer. You can feel the singer breathe before a phrase. And so not only are you listening to the orchestra, but you're aware of the singer's phrasing. And sometimes the singer is singing something almost against the tune that you've got used to listening to on the piano. And then the tune, the piano, is perhaps being sung by the singer, and the orchestra is playing something quite different. And of course, one of the huge challenges in Mahler is that it's, I always describe it to the dancers as chewing gum music. You know, it stretches. And you can't count it. It's absolutely impossible. You know, it's a three and four and one. And it's when you've got a group of people together, fingers crossed they will tonight, they're watching one another very carefully, because naturally they all hear that slightly differently. And what to somebody, and of course you need to be completely on your balance so that you're three and four and one. And another person might be having a little bit of a wobbly moment. It's very difficult music, and of course completely different from the kind of rhythm that you can count in a Stravinsky ballet. Of course, Tchaikovsky one shouldn't really be counting, but Stravinsky, obviously, you have to count. But with Mahler, I mean, with Grant, you see, I mean, I sort of often put my hand on his arm, and he knows that I'm concerned because he's counting too much. Because there's no question that if you keep counting for dancers, they stop listening. And the most important thing is that they really hear. They're really hearing something. They're not just listening for the beat. You want them to hear the sound of the music. You know, and the question of sometimes, you can say in a rehearsal, now you've danced this ballet quite a lot, and you know the opening of this particular phrase. Is that strings or is that a woodwind? Amazing. Haven't thought about it. Oh, haven't thought about it at all. I said, darling, you know, that's a flute. You can hear the flute. You can hear the and you can hear her breathe before she plays that phrase. And that's exactly what the singers do when they're on the stage. You feel them, and you know, if you gaze in their direction, you can see them fill their lungs, and it's wonderfully helpful. Absolutely marvelous, marvelous.
Malika, I could sit and chat. Or imagine you could talk probably for many weeks about your knowledge of the Song of the Earth. But I'm aware of the time, so I'm going to open the floor really and ask if anyone would like to ask a question to Monica Mason in the next couple of minutes. Does anybody have a question?
We should have warned you before. So we'll give you a minute to think.
You have a question in the middle?
How many people, hands up, how many people have seen Song of the Earth before? Ooh, lovely, lots. And hands up people who haven't. Ooh, even more. Oh, marvellous. And are the people whose hands went up because they haven't, are you all coming to see it?
Yes.
Yay! Fabulous. Well, I hope you enjoy it. And of course, I think it's wonderful that it's paired with The Dream, because The Dream is undoubtedly an Ashton masterpiece. And of course, Mendelssohn is relatively easy to hear, and not an easy ballet to dance. I think Sir Fred knew how to challenge everybody. But it's a wonderful contrast, Mendelssohn and Mahler, and I think it's a wonderful program. And I can't tell you how thrilled everybody in the Royal Ballet is to be in New York. There are so many members of the company who've never been here before. And I would like to say a huge thank you to the Joyce for... wonderful people with vision and courage, and it's taken vision and courage to bring the Royal Ballet back to New York. It's been been too long, and we love, you know, this was our second home at one time, and it wasn't that you fell out of favour. We always wanted to come back. It just wasn't possible. A question. Come on, someone's got a question. Yes, right in the front here.
If you're not counting and you're listening to the music, every dancer is hearing the music differently.
That's a good question. It's a good question. So if you're listening to the music and not counting it, do all dancers listen in the same way as each other?
I think they all listen differently. And that presents a problem sometimes. Because I think that if you know, for instance, if you know that this particular phrase is a six, say it's a six, and it's a one, two, three, four, five, six. So you say that to them, but you say, I'm not going to keep counting that, because I want you to listen. You have to listen to the difference between three, four, five, six. Then they'll get it. And then some people, you'll see their mouths going. They're still going. And sometimes you sit out front and you see the mouth go. But mostly they learn to do it. I mean, you know, I don't mean to be nasty about them. They're gorgeous and wonderful. But you do sometimes see a little bit of lip movement.
Yes, that's your question. There's a couple more questions. Thank you for that.
Are the ballets still notated or is video
applied? Are the ballets still notated or do we rely on video?
They're still notated. Almost all of them are. And of course they're filmed as well. So it's a combination of the notation and the film. It's interesting that Kenneth Macmillan used to say to a dancer, because of course it's only in recent years we've had quality videos. You know, at one time, the Royal Ballet relied on a wonderful woman who was married to the company manager. And she was actually responsible for filming a tremendous amount of surgical procedures in surgeries. And she used to arrive at the Opera House with her little team and these enormous cameras. And she would film from the back of what you call in this new Cock Theatre, the ring, the first ring in the Opera House in London is the Grand Tier, because it's royal. And she would put her cameras in the Grand Tier and film, but of course they were silent, and the music had to be added afterwards. The music was often off, was wrong, and the dancers would be dancing to the wrong music, but we found over the years that some of these films were so valuable. And without it, we wouldn't, for instance, have been able to remount Sylvia, the ballet Sylvia, because we were dependent on the film of it. But Kenneth Macmillan used to be able to say in a rehearsal, you've been watching a video. You've been watching a video. And I can even tell who you've been watching. Because what he hated was if you copied somebody. He wanted people to think for themselves. So it is a great teaching aid. But I think the notation is the most reliable, real source. Very rarely is something incorrectly notated. Very rarely. There's another question. There was a lady in orange. Yes?
Who was the first ballerina that you taught your role to, and what were the challenges involved in that?
That's a good question. Who was the first ballerina that you taught your role, the lead role in Song of the Earth, to?
I think maybe it was a wonderful young, well, she was young then, she's not so young now, Fiona Chadwick. She was a principal dancer, she was a wonderfully strong dancer, and in fact I taught her many of my roles. Yes, I think Fiona Chadwick. Singers singing tonight have come from London. Yes, Tom and Catherine. Yeah. Alistair.
You said the Song of the Earth is like no other Macmillan next one being Requiem, which he also made on the Stuttgart with Marcia and other of the dancers. And then the third one is the one he made on the Royal Gloria. Do you see any kinship between the three?
Did you hear the question? Do you have to repeat the question?
Yes, Alistair's asking whether I think that I see song as being part of a trio of works, Song of the Earth, Requiem, and Gloria. Well, of course, Requiem and Gloria I see very much as a pair, although one was made for Stuttgart and one for the Royal Ballet. Song of the Earth is sort of like the big daddy that came first. And then these two extraordinarily wonderful little sprites somehow after song. But song, Requiem was made by Kenneth after John Cranko died. So he made it in Stuttgart for the Stuttgart Ballet as a tribute to John Cranko. And so there are many quotes really in that ballet that I think are more Cranko. And of course, because he made it on Marcia Haiti, Richard Craig and Birgit Kyle, Egon Madsen, those wonderful dancers, it was such a Cranko ballet to me. And interestingly enough, Reed Anderson, who's the director of Stuttgart and has been for many years, they haven't performed Requiem for a long time. And he came to see it during the time that I was director, and he wanted to see whether it still stood up. He was a little concerned that maybe the time had gone, and of course he was very moved and thought it looked absolutely beautiful. And the next thing, I think he programmed Requiem and Song on the same program. So there's belief for you. Yeah.
I think we've got time for one last question. There is one last question. Yes, what's your last question? So the dancer you saw looked like she went through a life-changing experience. Do you feel that it changed your life, dancing this role?
It changed my feet. I think that when you dance, because you dance the second song and the sixth song, the second song is completely separate from the sixth song. And the sixth song is somehow a life experience. You feel that, especially if you're not 21, you know, when you dance it, you've got actually some life experience to draw on. Then I think you pour that into the ballet. And I think that Leanne, when she was dancing, it was probably already in her, well, she was probably over 40. And you've experienced loss. You've lost someone dear to you, family, friend. And I think that the ballet offers you the opportunity to really pour your feelings into it. And the way that the work is choreographed, the final pas de deux with the man, he is taken from her by the messenger. And so it sort of destroys you in a little bit. And by the time you come to the very final walk forward, although you know that the singer is singing forever, 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 an eternity, it's as if you personally are coming to the end of your life. It's very hard to put it into words, but it is, as Kenneth very often did, he gave people an opportunity in his works to dig down deep into themselves and draw on all their experiences so that they could really communicate to an audience something much more than just steps. It's about life.
Thank you. Monica, my final question was going to be, what in Song of the Earth makes it unquestionably a masterpiece, but you have absolutely answered that question with your last answer, so thank you for that. I'm afraid to say it's time to conclude this insight. I hope you found it insightful, enjoyable. I hope you enjoyed the performance tonight. Can I just say one last big thank you to Dame Monica.